Upon the powers of Arigungung, we call on the powers of the mothers of the earth and the sky and fire and water. We call upon Nana Baruku, Yemoja and Pachamama. We call upon the sweet waters of Oshun. Blow in the fire of change, Yayansa Oya. We're fired up to build a just world through borders. Let blessings flow, and we need all the power field forces that we can call up and call out for guidance in this revolution, in this era of transformation, in this age of enlightenment that is indeed a revolution bringing the planet.
Serving two life sentences of 19 and a half to 38 years, 5 to 10, 1 to 2, and 3 and a half to 7. And all of these are running consecutive, which means that I have to finish each sentence before I would begin another one. In Pennsylvania, life is natural life. There's no years on life. The only way you can get rid of a life sentence in Pennsylvania, you have to be commuted. You have to get a commutation that's got to be signed directly from the government. The primary shift that I've noticed since I've been in prison is the overwhelming numbers of prisoners who've come in the system. This large influx of prisoners have radically changed how the prison system has been handled. When I first come to prison within this system here, the prison system was lock us up, but basically the treatment was relatively, although they holding us captive, you can at least get the things that you need. Now, you can't even get clothing you need. About all you can get nowadays is enough to eat. I'm being kept here for two basic reasons, I truly believe. And those are, one of them is personal vindictiveness. I'm deemed as someone who will always attempt to do something positive on the part of the prisoners, because as I stated, I've become a pretty countless jailhouse lawyer, not because I thought that this would ever have me released from the prison system, because I don't really think it will.
All the things they say about COVID, how you think it's crazy. everybody's saying they can't do nothing about it. They might not, but that's not my concern. I got to be able to get to a toilet, you know, and I got to put people to answer all that, but that stuff don't work when you have to run to the toilet. And then, if the people up here and say they got single places, because I have a little meeting with one of the side little single rooms, they said, well, we can't do that because we don't have the power to do that. So I'm trying to be patient with it, but I can't be sick.
Of course you can.
Mess on myself.
You got a lot.
I can't be messing on myself.
Welcome, welcome. Hi, so I'm Sister Lavinia, a.k.a. V.
And I'm Kempis Ghani Songster. Welcome, everybody. We're very pleased and honored that you are joining us this evening for a virtual teaching for Russell Maroon Shoatz, where we'll take a dive into the issues of COVID-19 behind the walls, as it affects vulnerable elders and other vulnerable people, but specifically our political prisoners like Russell Maroon Shoatz. Think about what you just heard. Think about what he's going through. It's really heart-wrenching, but we're here to lift up what we can do to affect change on his behalf and on behalf of those who are suffering egregious human rights abuses in this time of pandemic behind prison system.
Okay. And tonight we have to emphasize the importance and the urgency of the situation. Our brother Maroon has stage 4 cancer and COVID-19. So tonight, We have people from all over, and we especially want to thank our participants for coming at short notice because they have the understanding that we need to get this information out here because we need Maroon released now. We're not asking them to take care of him anymore. He does not need to be there. We need him released now. So tonight we want to share with you some of the information that we have, some of the things that we can do, and some of the things that, you know, are actually being worked on right now. So we're going to start off and get into the health discussion first. And Brother Ghani is going to go and lead you into that about the diseases and illnesses that are lingering behind the walls.
Yes, thank you. Thank you. And so we have with us tonight to talk about as we dive into this health segment, we're going to be having a conversation with Mike Africa Sr. Mike Africa Sr. is one of the original Move 9. Fortunately, Mike is now home with the rest of the living members of the Move 9. Mike and I personally did a lot of time together, and we would commiserate with each other as we struggled for better diet, cleaner water behind the walls. And what is important about this, the diet and the water piece, is how even the diet itself and the water contributed to, you know, people being immunocompromised behind the walls, you know, before COVID-19 even hit. You know, Russell Maroon Shoatz, as V mentioned, has stage 4 cancer. He survived prostate cancer. And a lot of times we don't even connect the role that prison diet plays and the water plays in the diseases that people catch behind the walls. Mike, remember, you know, at Greater Ford, the prison that that we left from the year 1991 till 2017, over 600 people had died in that prison. Mike, you know, I want to talk to you about the role that you know, you think diet plays and water plays and the immunocompromised state that a lot of people find themselves in behind the prison walls. Mike, you with us?
Yeah, can you hear me, bro?
Yeah, we hear you loud and clear, brother, and we see you too.
All right, yeah. Yeah, so that was heart-wrenching to listen to Maroon in his own words talk about his suffering. I'm out here right now with Chuck, who is in the same situation, who spent 42 years behind bars unjustly. And he's battling, you know, the same thing as did Delbert, who succumbed to cancer shortly after he was released. Merle, 1998. Phil in 2015. Mumia fell ill. I fell ill. You know, and diet and water is directly linked. The ones who are surviving COVID now, they say how crucial it is for those people not to have any preconditions for them to survive. If you're in a state like Maroon is, you know, it's especially crucial that he gets the nourishment he needs to battle that disease. That they don't give it to him is just some cruel stuff, man. And, you know, they know it. Water, you know, if you're in a hospital, man, you know you have to get the best nutrition. You have to get the best diet. You have to get the best nourishment to battle anything you're facing or is going to be exacerbated by that lack of nourishment. You know, I myself became anemic in there trying to eat, and I was working in the kitchen, you know, and still became anemic because I wasn't getting the nutrition I need, you know, and it's just crucial, bro. It's crucial, and it is critical that he, you know, that everybody who can combine forces, man, to call or whatever they can do and get that brother home now, because it's apparent that they're not going to give him the diet that he needs.
So Mike, you know, again, like I was saying, you know, when we hear about these illnesses taking place behind the walls, and I'm not even getting to the COVID-19 piece yet. I'm talking about the cancers.
Right.
You know, it's not like people go in the prison with those diseases. They contract them right while they're in prison. And we don't often hear enough about the role that the diet and the water plays in that. What would you tell us something about your experience and your struggles, you know, dealing with the food situation and the water situation behind the walls? Because we know that that's something that you didn't just accept. You know, you were fighting for better food and for cleaner water. And what were the results of some of those struggles?
Well, early on, when we were down Holmesburg prison and the sisters was down house correction, we were on trial for murder.
When you say the sisters, Mike, you're talking about the women members of Move Nine.
Right.
Right.
Right. At the time, it was the Move Nine, plus it was other sisters there as well.
Oh, okay.
Other Move sisters there as well. And we were in the middle of a preliminary hearing with Judge Myrna Marshall, you know, with, you know, the diet, you know, you're going up to the seventh floor, they're trying to feed you these TV dinners and, you know, and, when you go back to Holmesburg, you know, they're giving you the various slop that they feed down there. And, you know, it was intolerable to us, man. You know, we knew how we ate on the street, because of, you know, us being made aware of the importance of diet by, you know, Moose founder John Afro. So we ate a lot of raw food. We exercised as much as we could, and ate as clean as we could because it cleaned our system. Anyway, so they was feeding us this slop. So we insisted that, you know, the officials deal with the situation of this tainted food. So much so that they gave us, stopped the hearing, the murder trial hearing, and gave us a hearing on diet, in which the officials came in, the secretary of prisons down there, the food manager down there, they all testified that it was impractical. But in the end, we got our diet. And not just something that they prepared, they went to the food co-op in our neighborhood and bought us crates of almost everything we asked for.
Like, for example? You
know, and garlic, boxes of garlic, grapes, onions, sweet potatoes, white potatoes, apples, pears, all kinds of fruits and vegetables, man. And I mean, I'm not talking about canned fruits and vegetables. I'm talking about fresh food. And so much so that we had our cell, not ourselves, a separate cell containing all the boxes of foods and fruits and vegetables that we won that case on. So, yeah.
Stop for a minute, Mike, because I think people need to understand this. We're talking about the jail system, the prison system, Holmesburg, where they were allowing people to bring food to y'all from the streets that was grown in gardens, community gardens, right? Co-ops into the prison. And they were actually, they actually designated a cell for y'all to stock the food in.
Right.
And how many of y'all were able to make this happen?
It was 12 of us there. 12 moved people there, but of course we had support on the outside. I moved folks on the outside. So, you know, they were calling, you know, they were concerned. They were in the courtroom when the hearing was going on. They testified, you know, at the hearing about the importance of diet to us, you know, the importance of diet to everyone, you know, wasn't no small thing. So, and it wasn't that they allowed our folks to bring it up. They went and purchased it.
But then when y'all
food co-op on 35th and Race, and purchased all that food, and they have community gardens or a garden where they would group or grow some of the food. But it was all organic. It was all organic foods.
But after the case and y'all got up, after y'all were found guilty and sent upstate, that was done with. That was over. It was a new struggle.
One of our brothers, Frank Africa, who was one of the ones they murdered up at the Osage Avenue, Louise's son. He filed a suit because he ate nothing but raw. And so almost, you know, everything they were serving except the, you know, the little bit of fruit they served is all he could eat, you know, all he would eat and at the time. But he filed a suit trying to get his diet the same way we had down Holmesburg, down the county. But they struck it down. They didn't let him have it. So ever since that time, whenever we would then file another suit about it, they would use that case against us, even when they was giving almost everybody who asked for a diet their diet, under religious means or whatever, you know, but they kept on denying us, move people, any semblance of our, you know, a nutritional diet. And it wasn't until the diet that I was forced to eat that I became anemic in 2013-14 that they were forced to then give me a better diet. Yeah.
I think, Mike, it's important to like, just to, for people, so people could understand the context of where you're coming from. Like, it's not just, you know, cause people, a lot of people in society might have this idea, well, you went to prison, you know, you're not going in there to eat full course gourmet meals and stuff, you know, you're in a prison. You know what I'm saying? What do you expect? But it's not where you're just talking about, well, the food is not prepared well or it's just sloppy. You're talking about the toxicity of the food. You're talking about the chemicals in the food. You're talking about the toxicity of the water. This is what you're talking about, the unhealthiness of it.
Absolutely. The water was horrendous. Ghana, you was up Huntington too, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And you probably recall that every time it rained up there, like the faucets would stick, you know, so that if you turn the water on, the water might be on for 3 or 4 hours until a plumber came, because it was so much sand and silt in that water system, because it was coming from a creek. And that creek was so contaminated on an ordinary basis, but after it rained, it was really saturated with a lot of filth, you know, so much so that it was stopping, you know, the water clogging the toilets and the spigots and stuff up there. Well, that's what we had to drink. Coming down Greater Fort, the staff won't drink that water at all.
I remember.
Right? So this water that they are afraid to drink, they are afraid to consume, that's all we're being served, and that's what they're cooking our foods.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, you know, the great lengths we went to get other water. And it was, you know, so if you have any kind of weakness in your system, you know, like you said, immunocompromised, you know, that's, you know, it's going to exacerbate whatever you have in your system. And to fight off any illness, you need to be strong, man. You need your system not compromised, you know. And you see, we always ate that way ever since every time anybody has seen us, you know, they see us being active, boxing, running, you know, racquetball, which, you know, we used to play, and, you know, we do the best we can in it, you know, but still, you know, 100% of the people, of our move people that was up Dallas, got cancer. 100% of them. And two of them has died. And as I said, Chuck is battling it, you know, in a battle for his life right now. You know, and Merle in 1998 of Muncie, and, you know, anyway.
Let me say this too, Mike. The yes. Water up Greater Ford where we were at, they found out that water was heavy with trichloroethylene.
Absolutely.
Or TCE, benzene, and chromium 6, all carcinogens, right?
Right.
And the water was so bad that it attracted the attention of a famous environmentalist and environmental justice activist. And they came up there and they did a big write up on that in the Philadelphia Inquirer and the Montgomery County paper. Could you tell us about what came about after that and your experience with the EPA agents and stuff coming to yourself?
All right, so what happened was one of Maroon's great friends and comrades, Kareem Howard, I had a conversation with him about the water up there and, you know, our battle with trying to get water and once the water was allowed in the jail, water that we could afford, because they were charging us $20 a case or a 24 bottle case of water.
That cost like $3.99 out here, right?
Exactly. And that was 15 years ago that they were charging us $20 a case. You know, so they had these. Anyway, I had a conversation with Kareem. And Kareem put this information, the gist of this information on the out on the air, and it was about the water. And he was saying that, you know, our brothers and sisters have been up there since 1978, and they don't even have clean water to drink, man. They're not asking for this and that. And said, you know, they just asked for some clean water, you know, and it's a shame that they can't even get water. You know, something has to be done about this. At the time, he was on the air with Pam Africa, right? And, you know, they called, giving them hell about it. You know, they called some folks on the street and, you know, that grew. So my son was the one who called the office of Erin Rockledge. And she got involved. She had the water somehow tested and came with the conclusion that you just recounted a few seconds ago about what that water contained. While they were telling us, you know, what happened was, as a result of that radio spot that Kareem and Pam did, they sent EPA up to myself up in Greater Fort. So they came, you know, I didn't know they was coming. You know, they knock on the door one day and it's two EPA officials, two maintenance officials, and two guards, you know, and they come in and they test the water and shake, you know, put it in a little vial and shake it up like, you know, they're doing some thorough tests. And they said the water was fine on the spot, you know. So the maintenance dudes left, and, you know, and then after that, my son called, you know, the office of Erin Brockovich, and she got involved. Okay. And she wrote that scathing report that was in Amber.
Yeah. Mike, we're going to get into this a little more because we definitely want to hear from Gene about the effects of COVID on the body. But, you know, why I wanted to go into that dive with you, why we thought that this would be important, is to show that people are already, when we're talking about the incarcerated population, we're talking about a population of already immunocompromised people, just period, already, before even COVID-19. Whether you're over 65 or not, you're already immunocompromised from the diet, from the water, from the toxic land base that it's built on. Whether it's Greater Fort, Mahanoy, Fayette, it's the same thing. I see Salim nod. I know Salim know exactly what we're talking about. You know what I mean? And so when you're 65 or when you're 77 like Maroon, you know, it's even worse. You know, it's even a more delicate and dire situation. And Mike, just one last piece. I remember when you used to smuggle tomatoes and cucumber and carrots and stuff out of the kitchen at risk of losing not just your little prison slave job, but being written up and thrown in the hole. You used to smuggle that stuff out to get to Maroon when he got released from the hole into population. You used to smuggle him fresh vegetables just to eat, right? And Maroon would tell me, go ahead, brother.
No, go ahead.
And Maroon would tell me, he said, man, tell Mike. He said, tell Mike, thank you so much. If I could eat like this every day, I wouldn't eat nothing else, right? It made him feel so good. And then what did he tell you when he saw you?
He said basically what you said, you know, and how good it made him feel and how good it made his system feel, you know? And I'll tell you something, bro, it's like the little things I was getting, you know, wasn't a chore to, you know, the staff there. You know, they wouldn't mind you taking certain things out. You know, you weren't trying to steal 10 hamburgers and all that kind of stuff. You know, they didn't mind you taking it because that was the kind of stuff they were throwing away anyway. So it wasn't like they couldn't give it to the population. You know, so they didn't mind you having a few things, you know. But my point is that nourishment, the same way it made Maroon feel, you know, is the same way it could have had, you know, the population feel, you know, because they had enough of it to serve, you know. And one person I didn't mention falling to some of that same treatment is Mumia, you know. Mumia, you know, because of that diet also, and because he was battling Hep C, which he fought for and had everybody get it, you know, the vaccine for that stuff, you know. As usual, you know, when he come up with something, he's the last to get it. You know, he's getting brothers off death row and they wouldn't take him off of there for another 25, 30 years, you know. But anyway, yeah, brother, I was honored to give Maroon those vitamins, that much needed protein, that much needed shot of something that he really needed, something that we all need, you know. And it's not a thing that it's a favor that you're doing us, you know. And people, for like you said, for the people who were saying, well, they up there in prison, what do they expect, you know. Well, we expect the same things you give your people when they're caught doing something. You know, you don't expect them to be tortured and starved to death nutritionally, you know. So we don't expect anyone to be treated that way. So, you know, we was fighting for this. We have moved. We've been fighting for this long before we even went to prison ourselves and became victims of the same type stuff because we knew what was going on, you know. And it behooves other folks, man, not to look at people the way they want you to look at them, but look at them the way we should look at them, with some humanity, man, and some caring. And yeah.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you. Mike, definitely gonna circle back. Go ahead, V.
Yeah, no, I was gonna say that's why it's so important for us what we're talking about, and we're telling folks, like, you know, Maroon has stage 4 cancer, and it has to do with the diet and the environment. And being an elder, these things are even harder on his body right now. And that's why we want to bring in Gene Snyder, MD, who's a family physician that serves older adults in West Philadelphia right now. And we want her to talk to us more about the COVID and exactly what it is, so we can understand the seriousness that's happening right now with our elders, especially those that are incarcerated, our political prisoners, and, you know, the things that happens with the body. So, Gene, if you could talk to us a little bit about that, and thank you, you know, for making the time to come and speak with us on this serious issue.
Yeah, so I'm honored to be here with y'all, and COVID's really been tearing through the prisons in a pretty serious way, and it's so difficult to social distance effectively in the prisons. And we see that the risks are much more in older adults. So while some studies have shown that the case fatality rates are about 2% in general, that goes up to about 8% among people who are over 70. So there's a much more serious risk for these older adults who are in these conditions where they just can't physically distance from each other effectively. And, you know, putting everybody in a gymnasium where there is not adequate sanitation and support and the things that they need to treat their existing conditions, the things that they need as far as support for the existing conditions that he was dealing with, is not humane. It's not medically appropriate, that he really should have access to what he needs for a safe and sanitary situation. And he should have access to his treatment and have treatment that's guided by his oncologists, that's really the optimal care and is not unduly interrupted. They've found ways for people to be able to get their treatment even during COVID, that they're being cautious about that on the outside, but there are ways that if people need to continue their treatment, they're able to do that. Some of the things that COVID can do to the body, primarily there's the respiratory illness, but it does cause other systemic effects. So the respiratory illness is going to be pneumonia and respiratory failure in some cases, but it also has effects on the heart. It can cause inflammation in the heart, heart rhythm problems. It also has a systemic effect that is favors the formation of blood clots, including blood clots in the legs that can travel to the lungs, something called pulmonary emboli, which is a pretty serious situation. And the risk for that is higher in people who have cancer. It's already like a procoagulant state. So those are some of the concerns that come up with COVID. And, you know, I'm not Maroon's doctor and not his oncologist, and it's important that he has continuous effective access to that team. And even after COVID, at 2 to 3 weeks, even for those people who aren't hospitalized, about a third of them, a little more than a third of them, still have some persistent symptoms. And so even though so there are things that we are coming to understand that there are more potential for long-term sequelae even after making it through the acute illness. And that certainly doesn't affect everybody, but it does affect a substantial number of people. Some of the things that they're doing, for other congregate living settings, so situations where people are living together, need to be in close contact with each other, can't necessarily social distance effectively, like nursing homes, and where there are vulnerable older adults. The Center for Medicare Services actually requires testing of all staff and people in those settings, particularly, and the frequency that they recommend is that if your county prevalence, or the county test positivity, so the percentage of tests that are coming back positive as a county, if that's more than 10%, that staff members should be tested twice weekly. And that doesn't sound like it's a thing that's been happening in the prisons, but people who are more deeply involved can, you know, tell me more about what's actually been going on there. And then I think that compassionate release is seriously underused and would be very appropriate for many of these older adults who have medical conditions.
So again, because I want people to understand and for us to highlight, you know, some of the challenges that those who are suffering from COVID-19 and these other illnesses, diseases that they are being passed and given through food, because we know for a fact, no one has left out and came into the community and contracted COVID-19 and then came back in. So that means that, you know, it's the staffs, the people, the workers that are bringing it in, and now you're contracting it. But what are the specific challenges that you may face, especially when you're part of the vulnerable population as an elder, such as Maroon? What are some of the challenges that he is facing now? And, you know, you talked a little bit about the respiratory, but what are some of the other things between the COVID-19 and having cancer as well? And, you know, his body being impacted because of the food. So.
Yeah, I mean, there's the blood clot risk. Anemia is very common in colon cancer as well. And a diet that's low in iron doesn't help with that. With colorectal cancer specifically, there are some associations that a high fiber diet, so all of those good vegetables that you brought out to him, as well as whole grains and nuts seem to be associated with better outcomes. And then processed meats and cured meats seem to be particularly strongly associated with worse outcomes in terms of dietary factors. And of course, anyone drinking benzene is going to be very bad for them. And, you know, the things that are specifically carcinogens are really problematic.
I want to thank you for that. And we don't want you to go anywhere because we want to, you know, talk with you a little bit more later on about, you know, just pushing forward and some of the things that we can do when it comes to helping with the health issues and then pushing to bring him home. Because in your personal opinion, would you say that it would be best for him to be released right now so we can take care of him and give him the care that he needs?
Yeah, I mean, given that he has a loving, supportive, like, home to come to, that I have faith in your ability to make sure he has great continuity of care and gets connected with the best specialists when he comes out, I think that would be great. I think that is so necessary. And truly, I think one of the things that's just, like, fundamental to caring for older adults is that at this point in life, you do have like certain rights to self-determination about your body. And it's not appropriate to be to be like forced into a particular course of treatment, that the decision making should be shared decision making, so that you really have all the options before you, and that you've got good support, and that you have a choice about where and with whom you want to spend spend this portion of your life.
Thank you. Okay, so next I want to bring in our brother Salim, but before we do, I want to read something to you that the UN said in a response to the COVID crisis. They said, the UN human rights experts urged the United States government to reduce the population and places of detention to prevent large outbreaks of COVID-19 and ease the mounting pressure on staff and the penitentiary system as a whole. We call on the United States government to act now. Failure to take timely action may have far-reaching consequences, they said. People in detention throughout the US are particularly vulnerable to COVID-19, and for many, their pre-existing medical conditions increase the risk of death. Okay? That's what the experts noted. In these closed and often overcrowded places, basic protective measures such as physical distancing and hygiene rules cannot be observed. Those at greatest risk should immediately be identified, taking into account situations of vulnerability, and release measures should be implemented. Despite some steps at the federal and state levels to reduce the population of people in custody, the government's response has been insufficient. Minorities, including African Americans, are disproportionately represented, both among the prison population and among those succumbing to COVID-19. Thus, any failure to effectively mitigate the resulting risk is also an issue of racial discrimination and racial justice of paramount importance. So this was what they said, and they also, this was just a short version, they also said release political prisoners first. Those links will be at the bottom as well, so you can see as we go through and share you some things. And as you see on the screen, this is what's said. It's not our statements. The UN has said this, and they said release political prisoners, release the vulnerable population. And that's what we're talking about right now, why it needs to happen. So I want to go to our brother Salim Holbrook, and we want to bring him in, and we want to talk about, you know, how we could possibly make this happen going through bills. But we know it's going to take all of us working hard and putting this information out here. And Brother Salim Holbrook is the executive director of the Abolitionist Law Center. So he's going to talk to us a little bit about some of the bills that, you know, the governor has talked about, has acted and not acted on. So.
Thank you, Brother Salim. Hey, Sister V. What we do know is that that warning has gone unheeded by not only the United States, because our political prisoners continue to be in prison, but also by Pennsylvania. Since October 15th, 30 prisoners have died in the state's Department of Corrections from COVID. To give you a context, prior to that, that is more than double the amount that died since March when COVID hit the prison system. So it shows that we're in an epidemic, and the response by the state has been one of just utter failure, complete disregard for human life, a complete disinterest in human life and the pleas of family members of people that have loved ones in prison. Governor Wolf has the power to release people. He has the power of reprieve, which allows him to temporarily release people from terms of incarceration. He's not using it. He was given a list of over 1,600 prisoners that could be eligible for release back in June, and he released less than 200 of them. What's really unfortunate about that list is that list was not based on vulnerable populations. That list was not based on who needs to be released, because if that was the case, people like our elder Russell Maroon Shoatz will be at the top of that release, someone who is 77 years old, battling stage 4 cancer, and just recently contracted COVID, and has been in prison for over 50 years. He should be at the top of any reprieve lease, along with Mumia Abu-Jamal and hundreds and thousands of other prisoners who constitute a vulnerable population within the Department of Correction. That is people who are over the age of 65 and people who have autoimmune disorders. But this population is not being eligible for release because the Victims Advocate Office, the Pennsylvania District Attorney's Association, and what I would like to call the Lobby for Mass Incarceration, which is now a death lobby, is keeping people in prison and blocking not just reprieve, but they're blocking legislative bills that could bring this population home. New Jersey released over 2,000 people less than 2 weeks ago who were vulnerable. And they did it not only for people who were vulnerable, but they did it to create space in the prison because, look, you can't social distance in prison. It's impossible to social distance in prison. So prisons are essentially just one big incubator. I don't want to use the term death trap, but they potentially are. So the governor has this power of reprieve, but he has not exercised it. And that is something that we are demanding, and we are going to be demanding that in the media. We're going to be demanding that through direct action, and we're going to be demanding that through whatever means that we have. One of the things that families of prisoners did and advocates across the state was set a set of demands to not only Governor Wolf, but also the state legislature and the Department of Corrections. These demands can be found at decarceratepa/COVID demands, and it could also be found on several social media pages like Human Rights Coalition, Abolitionist Law Center, Let's Get Free, Amnesty Law Project. But these demands are asking Governor Wolf to release people from prison in order to save lives, use his executive power. Listen, he has the power to wake up tomorrow morning and reprieve anyone he wants in the Department of Correction. I'm going to repeat that. He doesn't have to get anyone else's approval. He can wake up tomorrow morning and issue reprieve. These are temporarily releases, right? But we want people to be home. So we'll deal with the temporary nature of the reprieve. Exercise your authority. That's what we are demanding, because he can't use the excuse, I can't do it. You can't use that excuse now. You have the absolute authority. We're asking him to sign all commutations and expedite commutation hearings. They're asking him to expand, expedite compassionate release. It is inconscionable that in order for Russell Maroon Shoatz to be eligible for compassionate release, he has to get a death diagnosis. He has to have a doctor diagnose him and saying he's going to die within a certain amount of months. That is the only way he could even be eligible. I'm going to repeat that. Not be released for compassionate release, but just to be eligible for compassionate release, he has to have a death letter. That is unacceptable. We're asking for that to be changed. We are asking for access to essential services, healthcare, mental health treatment for the population, and to pursue any other measures, including medical furlough, to release as many elderly people as possible. We're also asking for him to mandate that prison guards, prison staff wear the M95 surgical mask as part of their uniform, that when they come in, they must wear this, because guards right now are wearing Make America Great mask. They're wearing just flimsy coverings over their faces, doing nothing. They should have those masks, as essential workers have those masks within the Department of Corrections. We're asking the PA legislature to afford parole eligibility to all elderly prisoners, to enact widespread sentencing reductions. And we're asking the DOC that during the time of epidemic, they should expedite parole recommendations, and that there should be transparency. And most importantly, because I'm going to close with this again, I'm going to ask people to search for those demands on decarceratepa.info/COVID demands, as well as social media platforms like the Abolitionist Law Center, Human Rights Coalition, Let's Get Free, Amnesty Law Project. But We are also asking to, in addition to Russell Maroon Shoatz's immediate release, we are also asking that the state include prisons in their daily updates about COVID in Pennsylvania. When they do that every morning, when the doctor comes out and says, this is what's happening in the state, we want people in prison, we want that to be reported. What's going on in prisons, the rates, the amount of people who are quarantined, the amount of people who have died, the amount of people who are infected. And more importantly, we don't want them referred to as inmates. We want them referred to as residents within correctional facilities. So thank you for giving me that space. I hope I didn't take up too much time, but again, please go to those demands, lift them demands up on your platform.
Yes. Please write some of the links on there, Brother Salim, as well, because everything you said is important. And thank you for sharing that with us. And, you know, that was, we're talking about as far as the state level things. And Brother Ghani, I want to pull you in because we want to also, you know, include what's happening on a global level right here. So can you talk a little bit about the stats and stuff about what's happening with this?
Yeah. Exactly, V. You know, it's one of the things we hear is that the movement that Salim is talking about and these demands are like opposite.
Yeah, so, you know, we are talking about the demands, right? What we can do. But one of the key things is that Brother Salim said the governor can wake up and he can make a decision. He doesn't have to wait for anybody. He can make a decision immediately. And, you know, for us, we have to come together and put the pressure. We have to put the pressure on these people that are in office, and we have to make them do what's right. We have to continue to fight. We have to educate ourselves on what's happening. And that's why it was so important, you know, to bring Brother Salim in and Brother Ghani. You know, we lost him for a second. When he comes back in, we're going to show on the screen. And actually, if we could bring the stats up while we're waiting for him to let you know, you get a little bit of an idea of what's happening in some articles, but to let you know what's happening and what people are saying out here, that they're saying, hey, the U.S. needs to do something about this. You need to release people. And they've been saying this, you know, since May, right? Really writing it out. We've had articles, other groups, the Pennsylvania Prison Society, who has spoken out and said that this is inhumane, that this should not be happening, that you need to let people go. So as you can see on the screen, the UN is calling. Different people are talking. And Brother Ghani, I think we have him back.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you are.
Yeah, I don't know what happened. But already, you know, countries like Turkey have released over 100,000 people. You know, and they have a prison population of 300,000 or so. You know, so they've released already one third of their entire prison population. Iran have released about 124,000 people, you know, almost half of their prison population. And these are countries that America, you know what I'm saying, doesn't like to be in company with, you know what I mean? But look, they're far down the highway in the humanistic way that they're addressing this problem. While the governor said that he would release 1,800, which is an insignificant number compared to what the rest of some other countries are doing. But even of that number, he's only released probably about 150 people. How many people know the name Michael Cohanan? Michael Cohanan, if it rings a bell, it's the judge or one of the two judges that was involved in the Kids for Cash scandal, where they were sending young children to a private for-profit prison. In exchange for some kickbacks. Well, he was released on June 19th. in response to the COVID-19, out of COVID-19 concerns. He's 68 years old. He had 6 years still on his sentence and he was released, right? If they could do it for him, they could do it for Maroon, you know, at 77 years old. If they could do it for him, they could do it for Mumia. They could do it, they could have did it for Al Joyner. They could do it for so many other vulnerable people behind the walls if they could do it for Michael Cohanan.
Thank you, Brother Ghani. And we want to bring Ben in.
Hey, y'all. Thank you so much for joining us. And I think I speak for all of you who are tuning in that this is not only extremely moving and traumatizing information for us to take in, but also extremely repressed information that is, you know, prisoners are not discussed in the mainstream media as part of the COVID crisis. And so you who have joined us, people of conscience, we appreciate you joining forces with us and sending a signal to the powers that be that we are determined to bring Maroon home. And we would really appreciate it if you could actually sign up on the website for this event, which is afroyaquimusiccollective.com/free-maroon. There you can put in your email address and we will be following up with you with a meeting time and also other very important information for future coordinated actions and events. For instance, later we're gonna be hearing from Et Cetera about the International Day of Solidarity with Maroon, which will be on January 15th. And we also are planning a meeting later in December. So if you could, if we'd love for you to stay involved in this, it's important that we don't just come for events, but also try to build long-term organizational capacity. So that's why we have all gathered here today to donate our time and energy. And we appreciate you sharing your time and energy and consciousness with us as well. Part of consciousness as an artist, I feel that the arts and culture are weapons in this struggle, and that art and politics are two sides of the human experience. And so we want to share some really amazing art with you coming up right now. In a few presentations, in a few minutes, you're gonna be hearing from Jasiri X. He's an inspiring revolutionary hip hop artist and community organizer based in Pittsburgh, also co-founder of One Hood, which does some really essential and powerful hip hop activism in Pittsburgh. Mm-hmm. So definitely look up One Hood, that's the number one, and then the word hood. First, we're gonna be showing an excerpt of a piece by Afro Yaqui Music Collective, which I'm honored to be a small part of. You're gonna be hearing words from Nejma Nefertiti, who is an incredible hip hop artist, and Charlotte Hill O'Neill, otherwise known as Mama C, a former Black Panther in Tanzania. This song was written by Maggie Cousin, who was a student of ours in the University of Wisconsin. And this was created through a residency at the University of Wisconsin's interdisciplinary artist program. So thank you for tuning in, and I hope you enjoy this piece of art. And we'll be hearing from Jasiri X. And after Jasiri X, not right away, you'll also get to hear from Blak, Rapp, Madusa, another extremely important kind of bi-coastal Pennsylvania artist. So stay tuned, and thank you again for joining us.
Thank you, Ben.
Bumper cover, police coming, the beast running, my piece stunning. I'm in here to make them see something. Brutality, our daily reality. Kill or be killed, my new personality. It's a setup, grab the bag, get them. They targeted fam, my comrades had to get them. Police murder people, lock them up and dead them. They beat his sister down, hit her till she bled, son. Corrupt system, she never got to kiss him. Her son didn't come home, they pistol whipped him. Tortured him, stripped him, and tried to resist him. Search for no permission, no rights, none given. Nothing different, same racism. Repetition, bust him in his eye, and took him off the prison. Who's the enemy? Shooting at me because of my identity. Bullets full of hate, screaming at me with obscenity. And penalties, full-blown weaponry, supremacies. No peace, penitentiary, recklessly. It's been happening for centuries. Try to take us out, erase all our memories. Accuse me of accessories. That's the recipe. Plant drugs on me while aiming at my sensory. Telling everybody they shot her accidentally. She didn't have a gun on her, coincidentally. She didn't have a gun on her, coincidentally. She didn't have a gun on her, coincidentally.
I hear those sirens. Makes my heart beat too fast. My heart's beating too fast, y'all. It's beating for freedom. Makes me wanna scream. Make me wanna holler. Make me holler. Freedom. Freedom.
Give us 1 second, Brother Jasiri X, the audio.
Y'all hear me now?
Yes, perfect.
Oh man, some audio. Yeah, what's up? Peace, everybody. First of all, you know, we coming from the spirit of free them all, the spirit of liberation. Honored to be amongst, you know, so many powerful artists, activists, you know, was just able to bill with Mike Africa Jr. about 40 years of prisoners. So they hear from Mike Africa Sr. After seeing that powerful documentary on HBO. Definitely just want to shout you out, brother. And, you know, the incredible activism you did, you know, behind the wall and still are currently doing, you know, definitely to Maroon's family. You know, who I've known for many years, you know what I'm saying? And I'm thankful to be an artist that's you know, been on the side of liberation and struggle for our people. I represent an organization called One Hood. We're based in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. We're artist activists, and we're really trying to help to really not only inspire but support up-and-coming artists that want to use their gifts and talents to speak to issues of social justice. And also we incubate, you know, young activists, connect them to resources, you know, to help them develop, you know, that next wave of revolutionaries we need to see actual changes take place. Before I get to my joint, man, I definitely also want to, you know, thinking about Maroon, thinking about the brothers locked up, also want to, you know, the brother that was executed yesterday, our brother Brandon Bernard, definitely just want to say, you know, may he rest in power. And it's just a lot of work for us to do. You know, it's interesting to me that we're at this time. You know, I'm in my basement, and you know, during this, you know, COVID, you know, we calling it a lockdown. It's not that, but that's what we calling it. You know what I'm saying? And you know, because we're like confined to our homes, confined to our spaces, confined to these Zooms. A lot of times, I mean, folks are dealing with like real mental health issues because unable to see their family, unable to see their people. And, you know, if anything, this moment should make us really empathize with our brothers and sisters that's locked up right now. You know what I'm saying? And the fact that you have people that are you know, have been locked down for years, decades, and haven't been able to touch their family members, haven't been able to, you know, really be around the people that they love and love them. And so this compassionate release piece for a lot of these elders, man, who have spent, you know, a lifetime behind bars is something that I definitely supported, Jasiri X, that we support as One Hood. So I'm going to get to some art. I could talk to y'all all day. You know what I'm saying? I'm honored to share art. And I want to share a piece of art that I wrote in this moment. You know, I'm an artist that a lot of the work that I do speaks to kind of a current moment. And, you know, looking at a global pandemic that disproportionately affecting Black and brown people, looking at a racial uprising where we're seeing day after day, you know, Black people killed by the police. We just saw our brother in Ohio shot in the back as he had his keys in the door, just trying to go home. You know, we're also seeing income inequality at an all-time high. We're seeing this pandemic where, you know, billionaires are caking up and the average people are looking at possibly facing evictions, a wave of evictions next year. And so I wrote a piece that I want to share with y'all. It's called Rob Jeff Bezos. Looking out the window with the Draco fully loaded, planning how to rob Jeff Bezos. How much is 1 trillion when converted into pesos? Turn half into Naira, I got family in Lagos. Contemplating though which plans gonna pay most. We want the bacon biscuits and the huevos, the queso, the banknotes. Gold by the caseloads, take those. We want the whole motherfucking payroll. Poverty is violence. Policy is silence. Robbery is science, ask the Carnegies and Heinzes. Everyone's compliant when you market in a tyrant. Imagine trying to live inside the carcass of a giant. The harshness of the climate makes us heartless and defiant. The hardships and the bias just compartments of the riots. Footsteps echo through the darkness and the quiet. Better have steady hands when you targeting Goliath. Put the bullet in the chamber, spin the barrel, feel the danger. I can't make it any plainer. You gonna pay us for our labor. I don't need no white savior justifying my behavior. We the manimals you made us, better call brother nature. Since my granddaddy built it, can I burn every acre, every fern till it's vapor? Till they learn it's the wager. Tell the governor and mayor if my brother is endangered by a major, I'll be swinging like Steven on the Indiana Pacers. Check the laser sight. Somebody better pray tonight, but not to that Caucasian Christ. Jesus had dreads. The same pigs that killed Brianna put thorns on his head for a public execution. We need fucking retribution. You can call a million cops, but you can't arrest the movement. Got my tech up to Jeff. Welcome to the revolution. To clear any confusion, we here for redistribution. And for everything we suffered, that ain't even restitution. $13 billion a day, shit, what's looting? While niggas making minimum wage, shit, we recouping. That he peeing down his leg, well, that's karma reproducing because his workers pissed themselves just to keep his product moving. Facing two pandemics, we beyond fuck. We already being killed. Nigga, we gon' buck. See, I was taught do for self, being freeze on us. Grab the cash. Now let's get that nigga Elon Musk looking out the window with the Draco fully loaded, planning how to rob Jeff Bezos. How much is 1 trillion when converted into pesos? Turn half into Naira. I got family in Lagos. Contemplating on which plans gonna pay most. We want the bacon biscuits and the huevos, the queso, the banknotes. Gold by the caseloads. Take those. We want the whole motherfucking payroll. And so I just, you know, deliver that in the spirit, the revolutionary spirit, you know what I'm saying, of our ancestors, you know, of our brothers and sisters behind the wall. And I'll say this to say, I feel like in this moment, you know, we need to be more radical in this moment. We need to be more revolutionary in this moment, because in this moment, we're really seeing the system stripped bare. We're seeing, you know, white supremacy, systemic and institutional racism played out in every day of our lives. And at some point, we're going to have to begin to rebuild a system that's going to treat all of us equally. We don't have that right now, you know what I'm saying? And we need to rebuild that. And so once again, we're calling for the compassionate release of Russell Maroon Shoatz and our particularly our elder brothers and sisters locked down, you know what I'm saying? We have an example before us in Mike Africa Sr., this brother's home with his family. He's not trying to do nothing except, you know, share his revolutionary wisdom with us, you know what I'm saying, and build with his family and his people. That's where we need to go. So thank y'all again, the Afro Yaqui Collective, all the organizers for this incredible event, for allowing us to be on and One Hood to be a part of it. Peace and love. One hood, y'all.
Peace and love. Thank you. Thank you. You know, that musical break was much needed for us. But even though it was a musical break, it was very conscious. When you listen to the words, it's supposed to inspire you. And that's exactly what the artists have done and continue to do. That's why we chose and asked these artists to be a part of this, to participate with us. But we want to get into a little bit of the historical context, right? We need people to understand, because so many times folks are like, hey, such and such is in prison, blah, blah, blah. Like, we need you to understand that Maroon and many of our political prisoners, all of our political prisoners, they never hurt the community. They never hurt us. They were fighting for us, to help us, to protect us. So I want to bring Brother Ghani back in here, and let's talk a little bit about the 60s and the 70s. Like, we need to really make it clear what was happening, what the climate was during that time.
Yeah, and I think, V, thank you for that. I think this really should be an open conversation between a few more than myself, especially people like Mike, because, you know, I was born in 1972. You know what I mean? And it should be really somebody that existed in that time to like, really give us a vibe on what that was like. But I remember sitting with Maroon in the holes in the law libraries in the hole, which at the time was really just two really small cages next to each other, and him, you know, telling me about what it was like for him. You know, he was born in August 23rd, 1943. He didn't even remember the name of the hospital. He said you'd be surprised if you meet anybody that remembered the name of the hospital that he was born in. But he had an early life characterized by traditional, strong, close-knit Black family, a family not far removed from the great migrations from the South. By the age of six, he had already witnessed two police officers drag a neighbor out of their house in broad daylight and kick and beat the old man all the way down the steps. He remembered the feeling of fear and powerlessness that he had in that situation. And he had grown up, you know, always fearing, you know, at authorities for a long time, or had a very, I wouldn't say fearing, but feeling just at odds in the face of authorities, even with his teachers in school. You know, Maroon said he liked to read at home. You know, he read anything and everything that he could get his hands on, but he didn't like school because he felt that the white teachers in his elementary and secondary schools behaved in the classrooms the same way the white cops behaved in the streets. Matter of fact, he called his teachers thugs and bullies who hid behind a thin veneer of politeness, you know, right? They hid their racism behind a thin veneer of politeness. As Maroon grew older, by the age of 11, he was recruited into the gang life. And for his entire teenage years, that's where he drew his sense of identity and belonging from, was from the gang life and gang activity. Spending multiple stints in juvenile facilities, but later on, you know, it was a situation where all over the country, you know, this was the 50s and the 60s, you know, the country was in unrest. Racism was being resisted against. You know, you had the civil rights era going into the Black liberation era, and all around the city, revolutionary groups, cultural formations, and political organizations were sprouting up, right? You had Ron Karenga and his United Slaves organization, you know, joining forces with food collection drives, and you had the Revolutionary Action Movement, or RAM, you know, going door to door in the roughest parts of the hood. You know what I'm saying? Like, politicizing people, talking to people, you know? And so even though he was in his gang activity, he couldn't escape that. He said what really started him down the path of consciousness was when his mother sent him to New York City, to Harlem, New York, to kind of get him away from the gang activity, to get him away from the trouble. And he said one day, you know, he saw just a sea of people just gathered in the streets. And they were listening to this one person talk. And this person that was standing before them, he was dressed in a suit, had glasses on, really clean and was just fiery, and the cops were phalanxed all around. But this person was talking to the cops, like calling the cops names, but not in a vulgar way, but just in a very intellectual and piercing way, and an indictful way, in a commanding way. And he thought this guy was crazy to be talking to the cops like this, but he saw the response from the people. And this person, by the way, was Malcolm X. And Maroon was standing in the crowd listening to this individual, you know. And the reason why he went there was because his aunt at the time told him, don't go around there because it's trouble around there. And he said that was the word that really attracted him, trouble, because that was his orientation with gang life. But when he went there and he heard Malcolm speak, he said his words were like laser beams that bored into his brain, into his heart and his soul. And he started to think more deeply about himself and his selfishness and just a wayward way that he was. And he found his way into political activism and fighting for his community. But it started at, you know, he founded the BUC, the Black Unity Council, which was a community organization, community organizing organization. They were feeding the community, did educational programs, provide security for elderly people, the whole nine. But this was during Frank Rizzo's Philadelphia, by the way. You know, Frank Rizzo and his Blue Guard was an oppressive force in the city of Philadelphia. You know, Frank Rizzo was the same guy that said that his police force could win the war in Cuba. They could take over Cuba. Well, this is the type of environment that Maroon was growing up in. And I think what the decisive moment for Maroon was when he saw a young boy that was killed by the police. And he was standing across the street as the police's wounds were tended to, and the young boy was just left to lay in the streets. And I think that was his decisive moment for really getting into the struggle. But this is the environment that Maroon grew up in and that produced Maroon.
Because I want you to touch on it some, because we see the uprisings that are happening again. And sometimes we feel like, oh, this just started happening with us. This is new. This is new terror and brutality. But in the 60s and 70s, you know, and before, long before, like, but we've seen the people finally really being able to stand up in different ways and being willing to address it head on. Can you talk about what the people were experiencing, like as a Black person in a community, as a brown person in a community specifically? So what, you know, we had to endure, because to understand Maroon, to understand our political prisoners, you have to understand why they had such a love for the people and why they wanted to stand up for the people. So for them, it's always what was happening with the masses. So can you just touch on that so we understand during that time why people had to stand up, why they had to speak?
Yeah, Maroon, he wrote a piece about fear and rage and humiliation, you know, where he articulated, you know, very well, the feelings that he had watching the state of his community on a day-to-day basis in relationship to authorities, how he felt as if his community was just constantly under the boot of oppression, how they were terrorized and they were intimidated day by day. And he saw the effect that it had on his father. He saw the effect that it had on people on his block. And Maroon was always the kind of person he was thinking about other people. You know, it animated him to act and to do something. And it pushed him in a direction that he didn't want to get into for real. You know, the community had asked Maroon and the BUC to do something about that little boy that was killed. You know, they asked him to do something about it. They asked him and Al Joyner and them to do something about it. And so now that Maroon is sitting languishing in prison, you know, for the community to not be there for him, I'm talking about the way he was for them, that'll be forever a stain on our community. The same thing that's going on now that the world is in upheaval and uprising about is what Maroon was fighting about back then. It's the same kind of thing. It's the only thing is they didn't have video cameras and, I mean, far as like cell phones and stuff back then, but it's the same exact thing. You know, Maroon is the same thing that they had Ann Smith in prison for. It's the same thing that they had Maroon in prison for community organizing. You know what I'm saying? And the situation with that is like, you know, if justice for George Floyd, if we're going to say justice for George Floyd, then justice for George Floyd also got to mean justice for those who fought against the things that took the life of George Floyd. Right? That justice for those who are languishing in prison for 50 years and over 50 years for resisting and standing up and speaking out against white supremacy and anti-Black policing. Like, so justice for George Floyd means freedom for Maroon, for Mutulu Shakur, for Sundiata Okoli, for Mumia, and for a few others. I won't use the word countless. Leonard Peltier, right? Because it's only a handful, and they're aging and they're vulnerable and they're dying. Al Joyner was Maroon's co-defendant, right? And he's not with us anymore. You know, the fact that somebody that stood up for the community like that, that wasn't in prison for robbing anybody, for burglarizing any homes, for raping anybody, selling no drugs, but just stood up for the community, to be allowed to go out like that, that's be forever a stain on our community.
And it's a lot and it's heavy, right? But imagine what our political prisoners are going through, what they had to go through out here and what they have to go through behind the walls. And, you know, we're going to talk about the impact that Maroon has had on so many people. And we're also going to talk about, you know, what has happened while behind the walls, you know, the growth, the development, specifically with Brother Salim and Brother Ghani. But also when we get to that, I want to bring in Mike Africa Sr. because for one, we pay homage to you and we acknowledge your struggle. And, you know, it breaks us every time we see the pictures, the images of what they did to you in the move. So we want to bring you in there as well because you have a relationship with Maroon as well. So before we get into that, though, we're going to take another musical break just to get people, you know, together, to give them a moment to soak some of this in and wrap their minds around it. And we're going to get into Black Rap Madusa, who Ben introduced Black Rap in the beginning. But listen, I have so much love for Black Rap and everyone else on here, but Black Rap is a founder in the founder and the ED of Mary's Daughter for the Formerly Incarcerated, and the president and co-founder of Dignity Act Now Collective, and an amazing hip hop artist. So I don't, you know, when you get a moment.
Hold on, y'all.
Oh, okay.
Trying to turn camera around here. All right, boom. Got me. Peace and blessings, peace and power. Thank y'all so much for having me. Free Maroon, free the vulnerable, free the real, free them all, free Black mamas, you know what I'm saying? You know, I first came into Maroon back in 2013 when I read Maroon the Implacable. Shout out to Ben. With the scientific soul sessions, we was getting it in way back when. And so we, you know, we worked to get Maroon out of solitary confinement. We worked with different groups to continue to, you know, free all political prisoners. So Russell III asked me to write a verse. And I never really like recorded it, but it was just something that I wrote. So I'm gonna mix it in with a little bit of, you know what I'm saying, call and response. And if you can, in your spots, in your house, where you at, you know what I'm saying, I'm gonna need y'all to say it with me. We gonna say Black Rap Mad USA. All right? So let me just kick it like this. 21 bar salute, dressed in fatigues, black tees and boots, little maroon on the loose, riding just like my daddy to show you I'm living proof. Pull up in the black caddy and tear off your fucking roof. I breathe the air that you pollute. Life ain't fair from Pittsburgh to Tuvalu. Bloods and Crips run up and then they shoot. Bastards of the party know we love to bust a move. Solitary confinement, know they love to take his youth. Liberation to gangsterism, but these ain't even gangsters, they plagiarism. Haterism against their own self. Kill a nigga and holler bigger whenever a pig don't ya. The East Coast version of what they had in California. Ecosessively said would bring atonement. White folks listen, ready to build our own shit. Matriarchy like it was across the ocean. Patriarchy, why we falling in slow motion? Medusa just laid the hydra that's causing all this commotion. Russian just said to get him, it wasn't the second notion. Spit it like it's acidic and fuck up your open folder like it hit that dojo. I ain't a soldier, I'm a warrior queen. Out here with RS3, blood of my blood until his father's free. Look what they done, they let Medusa speak. Now that's some killer speech. Black rap, mad USA. Hey, black rap, mad USA. Hey, black rap, mad USA. This ain't that bubblegum rap, it's mad USA. I said, you know everything I earned, man, I still had to take. Took a quarter from an ounce to a pound cake. Seven up from a lemon, siblings eating dinner plates. 7695, shorty on the interstate. 100 ancestors with me, agro talking, former slave. Well, do the math on the abacus. I'm going back to Africa. Like a man deep in them so widow passages. Rest in peace, George Jackson. Free my nigga Sensei, mostly up to Attica. Liberate by any means, I don't care who attacks us. But top shot out like a full metal jacket. Post taste for magic. Every soul wood from the cradle to the casket. Them ain't just bars, spoken word, it's semantics. Blind CC facts that I'm passing. Even if I'm speaking in passing, still tell by the speech of my actions. Now that I speak, reach masses, that ain't just defense mapping. Keeping my feet to the path for the problem that didn't look backwards. Black rap greatest on the Atlas. Black rap greatest on the Atlas. Mic check, smashed it and passed it. Manifested like a Buddha, no comparison to match. Black rap, mad USA. I said black rap, mad USA. Hey, black rap, mad USA. This ain't that bubblegum rap, it's mad USA. Hey. Black rappers, hip-hop like the stew up in your mama home. Old millennial like replaying some dominoes. Last Mohican, I speak and make it prodigal. Third eye, Jedi, y'all be cheap until it's logical. Get to the roots like a follicle. Balls of freedom, exercising demon, even cast keep preachers out. The good die young, we don't discover what they reach about. Yoruba tongue, I spellbound what I teach about. Black slap like steel drums, catch the leak up out of preacher's mouth. Daughter on my ears, child, brujas I conjure from. Professing better than your college does, minus loans to college fund. I rep Trayvon, but Islam is where my knowledge from. Black rap is Saigon, or what Cuba is the communism. That mean across seas, my revolution's lost with autism. My uncle just passed, I had to pray and say a pardon to him. We all gotta go, just pray your family put some water for you. It's libation pouring water for you. Uncle Taiwan, we pouring water for you. Lost in the slain, we pouring water for you. Trapped in the bank, we pouring water for you. A brown like sugar cane, pouring water for you. Black is like molasses pouring water for you. Keep pouring water for you. It's black rap, mad USA. This ain't that bubblegum rap. It's mad USA. Thank y'all so much for having me. And just want to, again, shout out to the boots on the ground. Y'all know we got this vulnerable bill coming out. We need all hands on deck, all boots on the ground. We need support. We're going to need some petitions. This vulnerable bill is not just for Maroon, our teacher, our Baba, our mentor, but it is for all the elders who are suffering behind the walls, who are not a threat to anybody, who are dying without any type of dignity, without any type of pride, without any type of love and support of their loved ones. You know, pregnant mothers are also vulnerable. You know what I'm saying? That they are locking in these cages in these inhumane conditions. So, you know what I'm saying? Again, you know, Free Maroon, shout out to all the people, all the comrades, all the activists, all the co-conspirators, all the supporters getting down. Peace, all of y'all. Love.
Peace and love. Thank you. Thank you. That was amazing. And a lot of people, just real quick, Black Rap Medusa also experienced solitary confinement. So you have so many people that have had these experiences and they can tell you firsthand, it's hell. It's inhumane. So when you see people working, it's through experience and it's because of loved ones as well. So this next part, we want to focus in more on Maroon and really talk about who Maroon is and, you know, why Maroon is so important to us. And once again, you know, we want to send our love and uplift the Shoatz family. And, you know, we want to do our part on this end, and we are with you whatever you need, let us know. So I want to bring in Brother Ghani to head this part up to talk about this mentorship and the experiences with Maroon.
So I just want to go on with my comrade, Salim. Salim, you know, how important was your relationship with Maroon? What role did it play in your transformation behind the walls? You muted, brother.
Sorry. Man, that's a really like tough question, only because the feelings I have toward Maroon, just even in the brief time that we spent together and the impact that he's had on my life and my development, could probably be about the closest thing that I could have to a father in the image of that father that I guess you could say I would have wanted or would have needed. Not to cast any shade on my old man, you know, love him to death, the outlaw that he is. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, that's one thing I gotta uplift, that my mother and my father, you know, wouldn't trade him for the world, you know? But Russell Maroon Shoatz, for me to be a kid in that environment, and not only Maroon, right? Because I gotta lift up JoJo Bowens, right? I gotta lift up Mumia Abu-Jamal, even though I never personally met him, right? Being in the hole, his writings had a strong impact on me. I gotta lift up Dennis Solo McKeithis, someone that was like, when I was 21 years old and buried in a special management unit, he helped save my sanity by telling me like, yo, bro, I respect your heart, everything that you got, but if you keep fighting this system the way you're fighting it, you're never going to make it out of prison alive, you know? And so for Maroon, like they were specifically Russell Maroon Shoatz to so many of us, man, he birthed us. Like who I am today from a political standpoint, from a human developmental standpoint, and even from the standpoint as a man, that could have only been transmitted to me by someone like a Russell Maroon Shoatz, someone like a Joseph JoJo Bowens. I even got to lift up Mike Africa and the Move 9, because when I was 17 years old at Camp Hill after the Camp Hill riots, I heard Ramona Africa on the jazz show on the block. I didn't really know much about Move, but like most Philadelphians, I was brainwashed about Move, right? But when I finally heard someone from Move speak, I was like, damn, like what, they don't eat meat, they're vegetarians? Like, I'm like listening to all this. And I remember every time Ramona made a point, they said on the Move. And I remember coming out to go to Chow Hall in the crowd, and Camp Hill was a controlled environment. This was right after the riot. You didn't walk out of the line. You sat where they told you, but I remember seeing, it might've been Chucky. I can't remember, this was 1991 Camp Hill. They was in Population. I was in Blues. He was all the way on the other side of the compound. I remember coming out of that child hall, seeing him. And I was like, man, fuck that. I summoned up all the little heart I had in my 17-year-old chest. And I yelled across the compound, on the Move. And like, you know, he like turned around and like, you know where you at, you know what I mean? And kept it moving. And I, you know, slid in with the crowd and heart was beating a million miles, because I knew that that little gesture right there would have had my little young butt in the hole for probably at the minimum 30 days, right? But that just really, like, I can't tell you how much being 17 years old, that like just motivated me that, yo, you can resist. It ain't over for you. You know what I'm saying? You sentenced to life without parole, you buried. And then running into Maroon, and I'm in the hole, 17, when they came back from the feds, and just hearing them back there in the hole. And they were the ones that were able to help me realize that, look, as much as I was reading books about political prisoners and the Black radical tradition and revolutionary movements across the world, I was not a political prisoner. Even when I was to the point where my politics was respected outside of the prison as a leader on the inside, I still had to come to terms with that. And another political prisoner, but he was released, Daruba Bin Wahad. You know, I remember in 2005, it was really when everything just clicked with Maroon helping start up the Human Rights Coalition, writing us about the need to transition, that we're not in the 60s, the way that his generation did it, the way the conditions aren't there that way. So everything that we taught you, everything that JoJo and I taught you, it's just not workable no more. You got to adjust. Use that as your foundation, but the fight is different. And for him to say that, I was like, damn, like, you don't, you know, that took a lot for him to say that. Like, yo, we lost. We fought, we rumbled, we lost. It's a different generation. You got it. It's a different condition. Really helped me. But then Daruba Bin Wahad talking about the concept of Black militant redemption when they executed Tukey Williams. And Arnold Schwarzenegger said the reason why he executed him was because he dedicated his book to political prisoners, right? 2005, that's when it all clicked in me. And by that time I had 15 years in, right? That like, I really have to come to terms with what I'm in prison for, the harm I did my community so that I could live authentically in the skin that I am in now, right? And so where I am today, I had tremendous amount of support from my family, from movements. I mean, Edda's on here was like one of those folks in 2015, 16 that I linked up with from out of Pittsburgh. It's so many people, but, and you know, it's even where I'm at as an executive director and moving all this work, had I not come in contact with Maroon, had I not come in contact with political prisoners, I wouldn't be here. I'll be straight. I would be here in a different form, in a different mentality, in a different state. But where I'm at today in my life and the work that we're leading, myself, and it's just not me. It's so many countless other kids. Because remember, we came through as kids, and Mike said something that we was on a panel, and I'm going to wrap this up with this, that when we came through, we had that, what happened to me when I was 17 years old, listening to Ramona, coming out of a block where anyone who was up Camp Hill knows after the riots, they was operating in a state of siege and terror. They was like, we lost control of this prison for 3 days. It's never gonna happen again. So any way you step out of line, the baton hit your head or you were placed in the hole. To hear Ramona and then to see a political prisoner in that compound, that it gave me that spark, right? All of that is the product of political prisoners. And what Mike said was something that resonated, and I'm gonna close with it. There were so many broke ass old heads in there that when younger brothers like myself, Ghani, and even the other ones came through with that fire and we wanted to fight, we were stomped down. Like, yo man, you want some nut time, young boy, this and that. Mike Africa, Maroon, JoJo Bowens, what they said was, not only are we going to feed your fire, we're going to protect you. Come over here with us. When that anger that you got, that rage, that you want to get better, but you also want to see a better place for you, for this world, and you want this system to come down. Come over here, young boy. We're going to protect you, and we're going to nourish and feed you. And I can't tell you how much, as someone 17, you know, coming through, to have someone do that for us and not tell me, man, get out of here with that nut shit, or don't come around, or you drawling and all this, like how that really helped feed us. And when I got older, when younger people came through, I was that one to say, young boy, come over here. I got you. You know, come over here. We're going to protect you and we're going to nourish you. So, you know, that's the impact, and it's immeasurable, but I just wanted to try and communicate that. They protected us and they nourished us in that protection until we were able to be them, you know, we were them cubs, them panther cubs, until we was able to leave out, and then we was able to do it to others.
I think you communicated masterfully, Celine. I think you communicated it for both of us. So V, we're gonna go into the STEM piece. Thank you for that, Salim. Salutes.
Yes, yes, thank you. We're gonna go into, I wanna pull Brother Tommy Joshua in on this, the founder of Philly Peace Park and CEO of Green Wall Street LLC. Brother Tommy, I wanna pull you into this because I wanna talk to you about the inspiration, right, and the implementation. We know how Maroon feels about ecology, right? About STEM, about so many things. And the name Maroon within itself, it has meaning. So I want to talk to you a little bit about the Philly Peace Park and how Maroon's teachings impacted you and that current work, like how it inspired you to implement these things.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Sister V. And salute to all the comrades for this really timely, really powerful event. Mm-hmm. I want to give a big shout out, big love to the long-suffering Shoatz family. And also we want to say free all political prisoners and all prisoners of war. We want to say land to the new African people. We want to say all power to the people. Thank you, V. Brother Russell Maroon Shoatz is such a giant, you know, I would even like to call him a hero. And I don't say that in any romanticism, because I think that they want to give the people heroes, you know, rappers, ball players, or anti-heroes, you know, but we have a real true hero. We have a true champion. And if anybody ever read like The Art of War, it talked about the generals who put themselves in a position to win. And in many ways, you know, us who are struggling in the revolutionary movement, we can say that we will win. And we can say that Brother Maroon Shoatz, his whole life of dedication, his whole example, he has made himself immortal and his work shall live forever. I wanna bring up and I wanna encourage people to study Maroon. There's a lot of, he has a wonderful book that should be required readings for all revolutionaries. And I want to raise up two aspects of his thought, V, that is really relevant to the movement today and also to the North Philly Peace Park. The first one is democracy. Russell Maroon Shoatz is an extremely important theorist. And I think Brother Salim really hit on it when Brother Shoatz told him, like, look, everything that we taught you, like, you know, we're living in a new era. I mean, that's groundbreaking in a time of so much dogmatism and so much unwillingness to critique itself. So Shoatz is important as a post-white supremacist revolutionary thinker, a post-white male patriarchy revolutionary thinker, a post dogmatic Leninist, right? For folks who understand that type of language. And it centers around democracy. So I wanna read this quote from an interview that he did that you can find online and I'll share the link. He said, the exercise of democracy / self-determination is paramount at every stage of a popular movement, right? And he also goes on to say that after all, individuals usually feel the need to look out for their own interests and to promote and support democracy, self-determination goes hand in hand with that need. Russell raises the question of democracy, democracy in our organizations, democracy in our movements, but also a conception of democracy for the community. So at the Peace Park, we see ourselves as carrying out what we call a local democratic revolution. And that revolution taking place in a new African community is essentially for new African power. And for us, new African power would be the popular and democratic management and control of the land, of the major institutions, of the economy, of the security, and also the ability to protect our values and culture. So democracy is a big thing. And Russell Maroon Shoatz, the general, he has his finger right on that. Now, right link with the need for democracy or self-determination for oppressed people, in particular the new African community that's here internally colonized in the United States. He also goes a step further and he links this question to the question of what he called food security. So let me read you what he said about food security in the same email. same interview. So he was asked, what are some of the alternatives that the popular movements of today can employ to actually combat the myriad structures of oppression that people face? And this is what he said. He said, one aspect of prefigurative work that strikes me as the bedrock is working towards food security, right? Now I'm gonna continue on. He says, suffice it to state, he said, primarily, we, the people, are prisoners of the large corporations that dominate everything we eat. He said, and actually they mass produce, they process and sell foods that has been proven over and over to be like slowly drinking poison. So I wanna stop there and I wanna pivot back and show how these insights of Brother Russell Maroon Shoatz directly impact what we are doing all over the country. New African revolutionaries and revolutionaries are reclaiming land. On this land, they are realizing that not only can we produce food that would nurture the body and help us to break our dependency on the system, but it's so much more because the land is the site of popular democracy. On the land, not only can we grow food, but we can also build new social relationships with each other that's free and independent from white supremacy, from white male patriarchy, from oppression, from capitalism and imperialism. So I want to raise that up, and I want to raise up that unlike a lot of folks in the ecological movement, Brother Russell Maroon Shoatz, he approaches this question from a revolutionary viewpoint. He recognizes that even though revolutionaries can engage and popular struggles to build food programs, to develop community gardens, to strike against climate change. He said, and he recognized that these movements must be tied to the overall popular struggles of classes, of people, of groups to overthrow the system. So these perspectives of the general has greatly influenced the Philly Peace Park movement, which is a revolutionary movement of people that's led by new African revolutionaries. And for the last 8 years, we've been striving to pit these ideas that Brother Russell Maroon Shoatz championed to work. And just one more thing, aspect of his thought that I think is really important. His comments on matriarchy is extremely important for the thinking and for us to be able to recast and to break from a Eurocentric patriarchal dominant view that has so long hampered the movement. And that's also refreshing. And, one of the things that I also appreciate is I can bear witness to his influence by building and having a comradeship with his students, you know, Brother Salim and Brother Ghani, and also other comrades who I met who was locked up. And when Russell Maroon Shoatz's name came up, their whole demeanor would change. You know, and they would just straighten themselves up and they would go into testimony similar to what the comrades lay here today. So without going too long, V, I would say that Brother Russell Maroon Shoatz, through his indomitable spirit, through his example, through his brilliance of insight, I want to say that revolutionaries don't die. Revolutionaries live forever. Revolutionaries become immortal because what they have lived for is immortal. They live for freedom, they live for liberation. And I want us to be unrelenting in our campaign to free him and all political prisoners.
Yeah. That was powerful, thank you. We were talking about the food, the situation with that, like what's happening behind the walls. And that's another reason why we wanted to talk to you about this, about the importance of gardening, and especially in a community, in urban communities. We've seen these movements, but not around food so much. Like we've seen it, and now is a better understanding, like, wow, Move was doing this a long time ago, and you know, they said this, and then you have Maroon who is talking about this and saying like, hey, the food is important, the nourishment for your body. The last thing I want you to touch on is just really making that connection about how important food is for the body, for your health, how important it is for us to start growing our food ourselves. So that way we're not at as great of risk for a certain, you know, illnesses, certain diseases, because the struggle around food is very real behind the walls, and the struggle in our communities with these food deserts is very real as well, as we can see that Brother Maroon lifted up in his interviews and his writings.
Yes, thank you, Vave. And I want to say long live John Africa, because, you know, oftentimes when we are at the Peace Park, when we are on the land in North Philly and West Philly, we so much appreciate the sacrifice and the contribution of the MOVE organization and the MOVE family. I'm honored to be here with Brother Mike, Baba Mike. And, these revolutionaries and these comrades have yet to be given their full due and respect for what they have contributed, not only to the Black Liberation Movement, but to the entire discussion around lifestyle, around longevity, along our relationship. And I just want to raise them up. The revolution for land, the revolution for food is extremely important, because it's not only a political and military oppression that we suffer. We suffer a nutritional aggression. We suffer a very dynamic spiritual aggression that actually comes from the food. And you can't really fight if you are not nutritious, if you don't have the energy to fight. Our children cannot go to schools and focus on what the teacher is saying. Our people cannot manage to get up the strength to come out to be with us in our campaigns without having that belly fed, right? So we must come back to the land, and the land that we must come back to, the North Philly Peace Park, say, is the very land within our community. Our position is like absolutely and immediately, as much as we can, the land must be reclaimed. The land must be received. And on this land, we must have a revolution beginning with transforming the food system. Now, when you think about the African-American experience, keep in mind, we were brought to this country and enslaved to the land. And we've been given the worst food that you can imagine and the worst treatment. And this continues on up until this day. But what we must do, we must seize the land and our communities and transform these vacant lots into food oases, into food forests, right? And by transforming our relationship to the food we eat, it's gonna taste so much better. It's gonna be readily available. It's gonna make you strong. Not only can you eat the food, but to go back to Maroon's point inside of this interview, he talked about the economic connection with it, the need for us to develop from what we have grown and have gotten from the land in order to strengthen our community as a whole. So I would say that, you know, people look at gardening and all of that as just a little fun hobby. No, what we are doing out there are we are making little revolutions. We are taking control of our lives, starting with that most fundamental thing, that which we put into our bodies.
Thank you. And that's important. That's important for us to know. We need to take heed to it, and we need to start working immediately. That's something we can do immediately. So next, we want to talk about the STEM work, and we want to bring Etta and Brother Ghani to talk about that, the Let's Get Smart work that has been going on that our Brother Maroon is behind as well. We want to highlight this.
Yeah, so Etta, great to have you on. Thanks for coming. Etta, you and a group of other brilliant movement folks and educators started an initiative called Let's Get Smart. Let's Get Smart was inspired by some ideas that Russell Maroon Shoatz had behind the walls that he's very, very passionate about. But before you get into that, we often hear, it's like Maroon, when people speak about Maroon's life or they speak about his contribution and his legacy, it's confined to like the first 20 or 30 years of his life. You know what I'm saying? Up to the point when he was arrested and incarcerated. And he's defined by kind of like what he's in prison for. But Maroon is 77 years old. And I think it's fair to say that the majority of his life, he spent as a mentor, like like Salim was talking about. He spent as a teacher and an educator. He spent as somebody that was always thinking about ways to make the world more livable, whether it was, you know, taking on the question of climate change, whether it was talking about mass education over mass incarceration, right? And coming up with this STEM idea, or starting organizations like the Human Rights Coalition to organize families to deal with human rights issues and things like that. And this STEM piece, if only people knew his thinking around this, I think it would give people a deeper appreciation of who Russell Maroon Shoatz is and see the different dimensions of who he is beyond what he's in prison for. Talk about Let's Get Smart, Etta, and why you thought it was so important to take that idea and organize around it and run with it.
Yes, thank you so much, Ghani. So Let's Get Smart really is Maroon's idea. It exists, the campaign exists because of him, and it's really simple. Essentially, Maroon heard about how there are so many online college courses for free, that you can access them, you can sign up and take free college courses, and why not have those be accessible to people in prison? I think it was it George Jackson who said, turn the iron houses of oppression into schools of liberation. And, you know, Maroon wants people to have access to education and information. And I think you actually, Ghani, know more about the STEM intersection. But for me, and what I know about is that there's this huge, I mean, there are thousands and thousands of online free college classes. Like, I could go sign up for one after I turned this computer off if I wanted to. And why not, with all of our technology now, the Board of Pardons hearings are happening on the internet. People are having, you know, people in prison are meeting with people across the state over the internet. The prisons have the technology to do it. There's really no, there's nothing standing in the way of this happening. They can't use money as an argument. I mean, it just seems like it's just a really simple idea. People deserve access to education. And so we're actually recruiting right now, right today, people who are listening. We need your help. So Sharon, one of Maroon's daughters, is a part of the, there's like six of us. I'm actually not one of the core members anymore, but there's about six people who aren't just in Pittsburgh. It's always been a long distance group organizing over conference call. So we really need people to lift this initiative off the ground, to pressure the DOC to implement these programs. So we have a sign up form that the organizers are gonna circulate, or you can make sure to sign up on Afro Yaqui's page so we can connect with you. We need people to attend meetings with us. We need people to have creative ideas. We need people who are connected with universities to help leverage that clout that one has associated with universities to push these ideas. There's no time like the present, really. People right now all across Pennsylvania are locked down. We're getting, anyone who works with people in prison are getting emails. Like the whole prisons are like solitary confinement villages right now. And people deserve access to programs. So help us. And not just with Let's Get Smart too, I'm just gonna intersect into the, because of Maroon's COVID diagnosis, we pretty rapidly formed a committee to like free Maroon right now. And we are gonna start monthly actions to pressure the governor to reprieve Maroon, which Salim told us that he can do if he wakes up tomorrow and decides. And I would like the Pennsylvania governor, Wolf, to take a, what do you call it? To take a lesson from Trump's playbook. Trump is not swayed by anybody's opinion. He frees whoever he wants. He's freed all of his friends. And I'm not saying Maroon is a friend of Governor Wolf, but if anyone with a conscience seeing a 77-year-old grandfather who is a man of small stature, the way that we talk about him, you might think Maroon is a huge man. He is a man of small stature, with a big heart, and he cares about people, and he's sick, he has cancer. So we're planning monthly events, and we're gonna have a first really big direct action January 15th. And then people all across the state of Pennsylvania and New York are having actions on Tuesday, December 15th, which is just next Tuesday, to honor the families and people who have died. I think 40 people in Pennsylvania have died because of COVID, according to the Marshall Project's report I read this morning, but I'll pause there.
Thank you so much, Etta. Ben?
Well, that was, you know, it's great. Thank you, Etta, for sharing the work with Let's Get Smart. And let's just take a moment to take in all of these attributes that we've been learning about this really amazing, historic human being. You know, Russell Maroon Shoatz is a theorist. He is a mentor, an organizer. He is someone who has uplifted thousands of people. His work on the inside has actually built new communities and new organizations and brought new people together on the outside. This is someone who has changed lives, no matter how hard the system has tried to silence and erase him via first solitary confinement. Just to reiterate for those who are just joining us, Maroon was held in solitary confinement for 22 consecutive years, which is absolutely a crime against humanity and torture by any metric. And now he is absolutely the victim of a strategy of death by incarceration. And now he's the victim of a strategy of death by COVID-19. He is COVID-19 positive. He is stage 4 cancer. This is a human being that needs to be released simply on humanitarian grounds. And yet we do want to draw attention to all of the elements that have made him so inspiring to everyone here today. He's really been a light in our lives as far as our practice of being a new human being, of developing a revolutionary course for human survival and democracy and anti-patriarchal society in this future generation, which we desperately need. So on that note, I can't emphasize this enough. Please go to the event website, which is afroyaquimusiccollective.com/freemaroon. And on that website, you will see a form. I think, Adam, hopefully you'll show this form a little bit here. And this form, you put your name and your email, and you know, we're going to circulate that with we're going to circulate that with the campaign body. It takes 2 seconds to do. And even if you can't come to every meeting, just make that commitment to be connected to us, because if we don't have this connection right now, I can't go to your house. I can't trace your IP. This is our only chance to build this longer term connection. Here's a reminder of some dates that Etta discussed. Let's see if this works. This is the old school, you know, organizing tactic before Zoom and fancy graphics. So on January 15th, we have an International Day of Solidarity for Russell Maroon Shoatz. There's going to be an action in Pennsylvania. So put that in your calendar, you know, if you have the ability to be a part of that in some way, shape or form, if you're in Pennsylvania. If not, I'm sure we're going to need your support anyway. And then we're hoping to have a meeting with those who have been here today with us on December 21st at 5 p.m., a meeting of folks of conscience who want to really put pressure on Governor Wolf to free Russell Maroon Shoatz. He needs to be home with his family and his community and his comrades before Christmas. So thank you so much for joining us. Again, you can make donations also to Russell Maroon Shoatz's he needs surgery. It's very expensive. He's also incurred lots of legal fees and lots of other types of things, clothing, food, etc. So if you go to tinyurl.com/heal-maroon, that links you to a GoFundMe organized by friends and family. And please, if you are of means, donate to that as well. So from there, I'm going to pass it back to you, Ghani. I believe you're going to close us out with a poem.
Thank you. Thank you, Ben, for that. I have hoped, I have planned, I have striven. To the will, I have added the deed. The best that was in me, I've given. I have prayed, but the gods would not heed. I have dared and reached only disaster. I have battled and broken my lance. I am bruised by a pitiless master that the weak and the timid call chance. I am old, I am bent, I am cheated of all that youth urged me to win. But count me not with the defeated, for tomorrow again I begin. The poem you see on the screen is a poem entitled Unsubdued. It's written by S.C. Kaiser, but the handwriting you see is the handwriting of Joseph Jojo Bowen, political prisoner, mentor to Salim and myself and countless others, close comrade, dear friend and brother to Russell Maroon Shoatz. Jojo has a stent implant in his heart, is also approaching half a century in prison. The reason why this poem is so significant is because you don't, if you know Jojo, you don't really imagine him being into poetry. But this is a poem that he transcribed and he sent to the streets. It's one of his favorite poems, if not his favorite, because it describes him, but it also describes Maroon. It also describes Sundiata Okoli and Leonard Peltier and Mutulu Shakur. It also described Al Joyner. It also describes Mumia Abu-Jamal. I am old, he said, I have hoped, I have planned, and I have striven. To the will, I have added the deed. They had a will to do something and they did it. The best that was in me, I've given. They've given everything. They've withheld nothing. They've made the ultimate sacrifice. I have prayed, but the gods would not heed. In those situations, you feel like you have to call out to something bigger than yourself. Or even like Maroon in the video that we heard at the beginning, call out to your children, your daughter. I have dared and reached only disaster. I have battled and broken my lance. I am bruised by a pitiless master that the weak and the timid call chance. Now I am old, I am bent, I am cheated of all that youth urged me to win. But count me not with the defeated, for tomorrow again I begin. Unsubdued or implacable. That's what this poem describes, our freedom fighters, right? But they are mortal. They do have a limit to what they can endure, right? We need to let our fight to free them be unsubdued. This is what they give us. This is the gift that they have given us. By every breath that they take, every day that they live, and every breath that they take is an act of defiance, because by all logic, they should be not here anymore. Of all that they have suffered. But the fact that they are still around, breathing, is a testament to the special type of human beings that they are and the strength of their character and their spirit and their fight. And they show us just by every breath that they take what it means to be a human being and what it means to stand for something and what it means to love people, not just a people, but love people and love the planet and love justice. Right? And that spirit is unsubdued in them. And that is the greatest gift for us. We have to return that gift by letting our fight for justice be unsubdued and our fight to freedom be unsubdued. Let's free Maroon. Let's free Mumia. Let's free Jojo. Let's free Mutulu. Let's free Sundiata. Let's free them all. Free them all. Thank you all for coming.